Hi, everybody. My name is Jaden.
I'm Eli.
I'm Jason.
And we are the Yahoo and Tor YouTube channel.
And we thank you guys very, very much for joining us. We are your family. You guys are our family. We truly love you guys. And we hope that you guys are having a wonderful week. And we are reading some very, very exciting messages from Messiah Yahushua. And it is what? What day is today?
Fourth day.
Yeah. So hopefully you guys are having a good week and you've made it through the hump of the week. Okay, so we are on chapter, or we're on chapter, what chapter are we on?
Hold on.
This is, I started this morning.
118, I think,
22? Yeah, 22, I think is where it is. Yep, right there. All right, everyone, sorry about that. Didn't have my game together this morning. So here we are, starting with this. This is super, super cool readings. And it won't be too awfully long. So let's continue on. Not all the Perishim were opposed to Yahushua. Only a few allying themselves with the Herodians because of him. One of the latter came to Yahushua trying to trap him by asking, "Master, your sincerity is established and your impartiality known. Help us, for this is the time of taxing. Shall the temple tax be paid to Elohim or to Caesar?" Okay, this is a repeat.
Yeah, kind of, but it's like kind of the temple tax. I don't think we've ever heard like who gets the money for the temple tax.
We did, that was one of these details that we didn't have. Why were they harassing them about taxes? Yahushua said, "Show me the coins you used to pay the tax." And one was given to him. Yahushua held it up and asked, "Whose likeness and inscription appear on the coin?" They said, "It's Caesar's." Yahushua said, "Do not give to Elohim the things which are rightly Caesar's, nor to Caesar the things which are rightly Elohim's." Okay, this was just yet another, we've heard this before, right? This is the same stuff. Render unto Caesar what is Caesar's, render unto Elohim, which is what Elohim is. So the same stuff we've already heard. 26, the next question was asked by those who believed in bodily renewal after death. And he said, "Master of the Torah, Moshe handed down laws to govern our lives. And one states that when a man dies, his brother should marry his wife, providing she is without child. Now, if there are seven brothers, the first marries and dies, and so his brother marries the widow, she being childless, the same thing happens down through all seven. Now, when the last dies, she is still left childless until she dies too. Now, when all arise to life at the resurrection, which one can rightfully claim the woman as wife when she has been legally married to all seven?" Now, before we read his answer to that, what do we have? What do we know that what Messiah said?
There's no marriage in heaven.
Yeah, there's no marriage in heaven like we know, right? The marriage is one of these things. It is an earthly thing, but there's a answer that's about to be surprising right here. 27. By believing in bodily renewal, you start with a false premise and have no understanding of the nature of the Ruach. Where death is overcome, marriage does not conform to earthly laws, which are made to mitigate the weaknesses of men. Tell me, with which one did the woman's ruach blend, and with which was there only a union of flesh? All right, so this tells us a lot of stuff
so
right
I'd
here.
I'd say the first husband. Should you go with the first husband? Because like those two are bonded in ruach first.
Well, yeah, that would be that. We don't know. We don't know which of the seven.
Well, I would think the first one. You know, Yah put them together. He died, but I think that since they were more bonded ruach than they were trying to follow the law.
Well, that's the thing about this marriage that we're learning from Messiah is that it is a blending of two fleshes, right? It is a blending of two spirits, and it is supposed to be man and woman. In a strange world today where it is men and women, that is out of order compared to what our Creator says. Now, this is something that should give a lot of people comfort, a lot of widows, a lot of people out there comforted, because when we lose our spouses, when we lose those we love the most, we don't know if we'll ever see them. We know we'll see them again, probably, if they're Torah keepers or if they're in scriptures and in this, but we don't know about the world to come. And it sounds to me like even though there isn't marriage in the Shamayim, that there is a union of the spirits. There is a flesh, right, of man and woman. If you are Torah-keeping, Yah-loving, Messiah-loving, and you have walked the walk and made it through the kingdom, I believe that we're not just going to go up there and it's going to be like we're back to, like, we don't know who anyone is, right? We're absolutely going to know who everybody is. We're absolutely going to have the loves of our lives, again, assuming if everybody's in Torah, That's who will be there. And I find that very, very interesting. And it also says where death is overcome. You know, that is what happens to us, right? When life is overcome, it becomes death, right? And we die. And I don't know. I just found that very fascinating. You guys have any thoughts on this or any kind of questions or anything?
I don't think so.
All right. So we will continue on. 28. Yahushua said, concerning the awakening of the dead, do not the holy books declare there's only a Elohim of the living? This is true. And those who believe otherwise are in error. When all life is supported by the arm of Yahuwah, how can he be the Elohim of the dead?
So basically says we never die, you know, it doesn't matter where we go. Like when this earthly body passes, we never really die per se.
Yeah, you know, and there's a lot of stuff. You know, a lot of people say that, yeah, when you die, you'll be sleeping with Jesus. That's what I've heard people say a lot. And we don't know. And, you know, one of my prayers, I guess probably one of the weirder prayers that I've prayed, is that I pray that I don't sleep. I don't know when my last moments will be, but I do know that the battle will keep going and that the kingdom road, you know, it's up to Yah whether or not we sleep. It's up to Yah whatever happens, whether we awaken in Sheol, the bad part of Sheol, whether we awaken in a place of comfort. It's all up to Yah. But, you know, that's the one thing is wherever or whenever I keel over, I don't want to end the battle for the kingdom. I want to keep going. And if there's a way that I can spiritually be part of that, that's what I'm hoping for. And yeah, like you said, Jade, it sounds like we never, ever like die. And so here we go. 29. Many people believed in Yahushua and had faith in his teachings. For they said among themselves, would the Mashiach show us greater proofs than this man? Eli, will you please pet Derps? Would the Mashiach show us any greater proofs than this man? Sorry, guys. And that's, again, we have 10 pit bulls, and they sometimes get a little crazy here. All right. The question was, would the Mashiach show us any greater proofs than this man? And that's a question they had amongst themselves.
I mean, I think they should see enough. I mean, those people are just healing, just raising the dead. You would think they had seen enough to point, like, hey, man, this dude has to be from Elohim. And it's like, if he's not at least a prophet or something, he has to be the son of Elohim.
Who have we seen raised from the dead before Mashiach? We had the boy with Elijah, right?
Right. We had this one time when Elijah's bones were thrown into a cave. This guy came out.
Yeah.
And came back to life.
Right. And we know that, you know, so it was a rare thing, you know, coming back to life. That's something that we know that, in fact, you know, if we saw somebody come back to life, we would probably run for our lives because it would scare the heck out of us.
I guess. You probably maybe happy, but if they die, you like probably freak out like, hey, whoa.
It doesn't matter. If you're sitting there burying a cold, dead corpse and the thing reaches up and it grabs a hold of you or like sits up, everybody's probably going to drop him and is probably going to run. It's not going to be something you have. It's not what you're expecting. And unless you have Messiah there saying, rise and get up, it's not going to make any sense to you. And you're like, okay, now we got the dead coming to life. Okay, 30. Because of the things said and done by many concerning Yahushua, those who held power, fearing a disturbance, sent guards to seize him. But he said to the captain, I am only here for a few days, and then I must go, following the path of my obligation. Seek me then, for I will be in a place beyond your reach. I follow a chosen path, and none may follow. We each have a duty, but you have discretion whether to take me or not. My frailties say, go with him, but my heart calls me to duty. Anyone want to try to explain what he just said there?
He basically said that he has his own job to do. He has his own thing that is going to happen. He can pick him up then, which is him dying on the cross, which is him dying. He basically told the guard to come arrest him later in a few days when it's actually time.
Yeah, and so this incident, right? So the captain of the guard, which means there is a guard with him, right? And so there's a whole bunch of people that came, and he's having a conversation with him. And they were going to pick him up right here. And he's just having a conversation. Messiah's having a conversation with this guy. The 32. The captain of the guard said, whom do you serve so dutifully? Yahushua replied, I serve Yahuwah. Now, if there was a Trinity, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit,
it would be weird.
This would be really weird.
He's basically saying, I serve myself,
right?
And that'd be a problem. They'd be like, oh, that's pompous, let's put him to death.
Yeah, and you know, that's what everybody in the world does. Everybody serves themselves, right? And that's not, he serves Yahuwah, and that's who we need to serve, right? 34. Then the captain said, the priests serve Yahuwah, and you are not a priest. And it is said, you call yourself the servant of man, but who is he? Yahushua answered, the service rendered by priests is meaningless unless it also serves man. For service in the name of Elohim is likewise service in the cause of man. Can your sword arm serve one master and your shield arm another?
No.
The captain said, Master, I can see that you are a man dedicated to duty. Whether your cause be just or unjust, whether you be friend or foe, it is not within my understanding to know. But a man whose heart is ruled by the demands of duty, I can understand. I can tell those who sent me that shortly you leave for a distant place where none can follow, and they will leave you alone. So, you know, the captain of the guard made his decision, right? And, you know, if you send somebody out who has the authority to arrest somebody and that guy comes back and says, I didn't arrest him, this captain of the guard probably got in some trouble right here. He probably...
Like, where is he? Where's Joshua?
We sent you out. You are the paid soldiers of probably the temple. And this is very
interesting. This guy saw no wrong in Joshua. He did what better than a lot of other people did. They wanted to beat him. They wanted to take him. He's like, dude, this, he actually rightly ruled him.
Right. And he says, I will be gone in just a little bit. And here we go. When those who sent to Yahushua heard this, they said, perhaps he goes to the Greeks or to the islands in the sea. Therefore, we will ignore him. Yahushua went and rested among the columns of Solomon. And while some people came and asked why he did not declare himself and reveal he was the Mashiach, and Yahuwah's appointed, the promised one from the stock of David, Yahushua said, my works and words declare me and establish my title. Those who heed my message enter the proper fold. And a good shepherd protects his flock, seeing none goes astray or is taken by wolves. Though these are my first care, I seek to bring all men into the fold best suited for them. And I am prepared to die if thereby I can bring men into the fold, leading to the fields of everlasting life. The deeds whereby men save their lives on earth may cost them a life in glory. But whoever lays down his life for the cause of Elohim shall surely know eternal life. Hardcore stuff, right?
Yeah.
I come to sow strife among men, so they may be roused from the sleep of apathy. I come to strengthen the poor, so they may take heart and throw off the yoke imposed by the privileged. This is my message for the wealthy. Enjoy your ill-gotten goods. Console yourselves with comfort, and buy the fickle goodwill of men. Make merry while you may. Close your eyes to the harshness of reality, for the day will surely come when your body weakens. The pleasures pall, and you glimpse the dark doorway ahead. Be certain that the only welcome you will get on the other side is from the Ruach of darkness, who will escort you to a proper place in their dismal abode. Oh, that's scary, right? All of a sudden you know, if you die in evil, if we die, we are going to have there's a guard, right? The Ruach of darkness, right?
And escort us to fires.
Yeah, and I remember when I was it was much, much years ago. Back when we were watching evil things, we watched a story, a movie called Ghost. I think it had Patrick Swayze and Demi Moore. And when they died, these ghoul things, these creepy black dark things would come and all of a sudden surround the dead corpse and would run and take off with its spirit. And it was creepy because these things screamed all the way to the end. And that right there is kind of what that just sounds like, right? And you have the spirit of darkness who's going to escort you to a proper place in their dismal abode, right? It sounds like we should be really very, very careful of our soul. Very careful. Because of the combination of the rich who misused their wealth, and nearly all of them did, the priests were angry with Yahushua, for they depended on rich patrons. They said, who are you to revile your betters when you are no more than a loud-tongued beggar?
You know, this reminds me of people like the donations. It's like the whole donation thing right here.
It's the donations, yeah. I mean, that's the thing. You're exactly right. You know, we have multiple Bible vendors that have...
even teachers, like, I can't do this without your donations.
Yeah, absolutely. Every one of these people. And that's why the Boss Clan does not have donations. There is absolutely no way to donate to Boss Clan. If you want to donate to us, go find somebody and give them a big hug and tell them our creator loves them and show them the way forward, right? Give them just a little bit of love in this thing. And that's the only donations we've ever asked anyone for. Okay, 43. Yahushua said, "Is it not written in the holy books, disregard outward appearances, for these may conceal either treasure or garbage. Only Yahuwah knows what really lies within. The body is only the outer covering shed at death. What matters is the likeness of the ruach it clothes."
Kind of like bugs, they molt.
Yeah.
You know, they like shed the old skin, they get a new skin.
Yeah, and you know, it's people need to understand this body that we have is going to die. It will pass away. But what we have is we have a chance with our spirit. We have a chance at eternity, in a good eternity versus, you know, that. And this is where we have to be seeking this Torah. We have to be seeking this kingdom. And if it just doesn't cross your mind, if it just doesn't interest you, then our creator probably isn't going to be interested with you. And Messiah is going to tell you to depart, you who are Torahless. Okay, we're almost done. Let's continue. 44. One of the priests said, "You claim to save through baptism, a cleansing by fire and water. But while these are both great purifiers, how can they deliver man from sin?" Yahushua said, and everyone needs to listen up very closely because I think this is the meat and potatoes of this entire thing. "Water and fire are purifiers of earthly things. But I tell you that unless men be cleansed in the waters of contrition, and tested in the fires of adversity, they cannot enter the kingdom of heaven." All right, we're going to leave it at that. And this is, you know, this is hardcore, right? A lot of times, and I'm not going to get into it with our family, but we are having a dog issue. And one of our family members is in dire shape, and he may not make it. And we are going through the fires of adversity. We are going through, and we're going to be tested. And you can either scream at our creator and yell at him and say, "It's not fair, it doesn't, it's not, it, all of it." Or you can pray that you are worthy to be accepted in the trials of fire, right? That is what we need to do, is we need to say, "Thank you for these tribulations. Thank you for allowing us to have these human emotions, for giving us this time and these actions and living this life as humans to have this kind of experience." And not all the experiences of humankind are good. There's a lot of sadness in this world. There's a tremendous amount of sadness, especially when you're dealing with the loss of people and animals and things of that nature, right? It's just, as humans, we break very easily. But if you think that you're being tested beyond what you can, we know the scripture says you will not be tested more than you can take, but we will be tested. And so don't expect a perfect life. Don't expect everything to go right. Don't expect, you know, in fact, if you are a Torah keeper, if you are serving our Elohim, you have the faith of Messiah Yahushua, then you need to expect hard testing. You need to expect that the devil is going to come and attempt to sift you, and he's going to try to shake your faith. He's going to try to shake your love for our creator, and he's going to try to shake your foundations of belief. And when you fall to that kind of testing, then we are not making it. And Messiah says that we will be tested in the fires of adversity. And if we are not, we cannot enter the kingdom of heaven. Guys, we'll leave you with that. We love you guys very, very much. We hope you guys have a wonderful day. And we're out.
All right. Shalom.